My name is Jonas, call me Richard Jonas because it's easier. I work at the Erlang Solutions in Hungary, in the Budapest office, and we are working very hard on the product called Wombat, which is the product of the Erlang Solutions. In this presentation, I will show you the features and the functionalities of Wombat has, and what Wombat is good for, and what you can gain if you're using Wombat. So, if you run into the or one of the salesperson, maybe he will tell that these two concise sentences what Wombat is. So, Wombat is a monitoring and operations framework for giving full visibility of the Erlang nodes in the system. It can provide some lot of information. I will describe you later. But if you would like to see what Wombat is, then you will see something similar to that. Wombat is an Erlang application, and the main functionality is written in Erlang, and it's a server-based application. So some kind of Erlang application is running and gathering all the informations about the nodes we are managing. And somehow that information needs to show to the user, and we chose the web application style architecture. We have a web-based UI, and I will show you. It connects to the Wombat server side, and you can access the main functionalities of Wombat, and in each functionality there are sub-functionalities, and you can also get some kind of nice navigation, and the content will be displayed here depending on what functions on what node you are interested in. Okay, that's nice, but it doesn't say too much about Wombat. What features Wombat have? Wombat can monitor nodes, can say if a node is a big cluster in the big Erlang form, is up, down, what kind of connectivity, so the health of the connectivity it has. Since Wombat is intended in mind to be used in a cluster or in a server data center where there can be 100, 500 or even many thousand nodes, we need to group somehow the nodes what Wombat is handling. So we decided now to have some kind of simple grouping of the nodes by the Erlang releases, so at least we can access the nodes easily in two steps. Wombat also can collect metrics from those nodes in order to show the state and the health of the nodes again. And we can see the metrics in some nice graphs provided by the user interface. Wombat can also capture logs and show error messages, show the alarms, and it has a feature which is called orchestration, and it's for deploying releases either on bare metal or in the cloud. So you can ask that why we started developing Wombat, because there are some kind of homegrown applications in some companies, not every company has that, with which one can monitor those things, at least parts of those things, what we can provide. There is a commercial open source tool called Nagios, which has an Erlang plugin, but I think the functionality of this Erlang plugin is very basic. You can see that only if the node is up and running or what kind of applications and running, but nothing more. The monitoring is solved in the library level as well, so we have Foursome and Exometer libraries, but the problem can still need to be solved, how to show the data to the user, how to collect the data, how to store those data. So those libraries are very great and it's useful to use that, but it's still that problem needs to be solved. Entropy is also a good application showing the reductions, and then you can get some insight what's going on in the Erlang VM. But I think those applications are good for deep monitoring, but when you have a large cluster and you like to identify the problem, where are the problems, on for which nodes have problems, then those solutions can be a bit of scattered, at least not easy to be worked with. Okay, let's say after that what kind of functionalities, what is the base functionality of Wombat, and then later we can see how Wombat works. In order that the Wombat can access the nodes, we need to somehow connect with the nodes. We make hidden connections to the Erlang nodes through the EPMD, and by those hidden connections, we try to remain as non-intrusive as possible, because that's the first and maybe sometimes the only priority, that if we connect to some kind of production cluster, it wouldn't be a good idea to kill those nodes, because that demolish the trust in Wombat. So we are using hidden connections, so the Wombat won't be in the displayed in the cluster. By that, we can monitor the nodes by node monitoring, so we can say that node are up or down. And if we would like to add nodes, then we can specify the node name as an atom in the web UI, and we also need to specify the cookie in order that Wombat can connect to the node. If we have a cluster or something like that which has many, many nodes, then maybe it's very uncomfortable to add nodes one by one. That's why we built a functionality called our node discovery. So I need to specify only one node in the cluster, and Wombat can connect to all the nodes in the cluster without a discovery. It's a very useful feature. So now we are we know that what's the base of the Wombat functional architecture, so the topology. Now we can speak about what Wombat is. Wombat is an application which has some core application functionalities implemented in the modules. It's not so interesting. We are collecting the data in Amnesia database, we have event managers, we are using GPROS, we have UI components implemented by the Cowboy REST interfaces. But the main part and the most interesting part are the plugin architecture. So topology, what I described before, is the essential component of Wombat, but we can define several other components for collecting information about managed nodes. We have several managed nodes. A plugin, like the Matrix plugin, have two parts. One part is operated in Wombat, and one part will be injected in the Erlang node. So we are doing remote code injection, and we are calling that part of the plugin the agent module. And the rest of the functionality will be done by Wombat. Sometimes it seems to be intrusive, but we know that it's a great responsibility that we are injecting agent codes, Erlang modules into the Erlang node, because it can affect the stability of Erlang node, and we are keeping take care of the performance and the also the security reasons, security things that we need to establish in order that that node should operate seamlessly. So we have the agent code injected here, and the Matrix plugin can communicate with the Erlang node through RPC calls, and it can collect information about this managed node. We have several other plugins, and that those plugins are controlled by the plugin handle of Wombat, which is responsible for loading, initializing, and unloading the plugins. one can easily define another plugin, so the Wombat architecture can be extended. That was the case some months ago. Now we are calling those our services, and the plugin architecture will be something else. And we are making the plugin implementation much more easier. So after that, let's demonstrate what are the plugins do. So at first, I would like to describe the metrics plugin, which has an agent part, which will be injected in the manage node, as I mentioned before, and can ask 100 different metrics built in into the Wombat plugin, so-called process-related messages, memory-related, CPU-related, and other tiny metrics. We are also integrated with Foursome and Exometer, so if manage node has an application which using Foursome, then we can get all the Foursome metrics. That's very good because with that solution, we integrated several other applications for free, like React, or like load tester tool, the Megaload is using Exometer, so we can also measure how Megaload works. Metrics agent, so that injected module is a passive one, so it's a library module. We just load the module into the manage node, and the Wombat will call RPC calls. So that's the most, I think, non-intrusive plugin in the Wombat architecture. We are also using integration with, so we are integrated not just the applications running on the manage nodes, but the applications are using the information the Wombat can extract from the nodes. Like we can push the metrics we have into graphite. So, yeah, I think we have a four node React cluster here. We can check the member status. You can see that the ring is ready. And oops. Then I can access the Wombat web interface from the localhost because it's installed. And I can add a node, which is our guinea pig. It contains everything what we want to test. So we add the WIO test, the Wombat test node running here. And each node got a generated ID. It has a name. This is the boot script ID of the node, what I mentioned. So that's the node family, and the nodes which has this boot script ID will be put into that node family, and we can measure the liveliness or health of a node family, so all the nodes together. Now we can see that the state is up, and we can see the cookie as well. Let's see something different. We have this dev one on the local host and the cookie is React, so we want to add the React node. It happened pretty quickly, so we have this free node React cluster, and each is up and running. We are very happy. We can see the IDs and so on. Let's put some, there is a script here. Maybe I can make the fonts bigger. So it's just put some load on the React. It's not so interesting. Just put random keys and get random keys. And we can see, at least check the test node, giving some time Wombat to collect metrics. It has several memory metrics, like the total memory. Maybe the screen is not too big, but no problem. We can add the ETS memory as well. So after some time, we need to see I will make this smaller. So we can see the ETS memory here, which is sampled in a well-specified time interval. During that time, React has some metrics. There are counters and gradients. I will mention them later, but I will need to show you the React puts. So we just put 0 and then 22 keys during this demo, and it's still growing. Okay, let's switch back to the... As you can see, we have a bunch of Folsom metrics. We can get information for all the V nodes, and yeah. So just check the React documentation to see what's happening. So metrics can be collected, but since we have 100 built-in metrics and Folsom can provide 50 metrics and Exomaton can provide another 20, it's very important to have a good metrics configuration and to understand how it works. We have this very concise configuration string, meaning that we need to get metrics in every 10 seconds, and I want those samples to be retained for 1 hour. So those are the base sampling. And since sometimes I want to see the bigger picture, to memory usage or the disk usage for the last day or for the last month, then I need to consolidate those data because I don't want to process so much data at a time. This defines, this configuration defines the first consolidating series, which means that in the last minute, let's collect all the samples that we have, compute an average, and store that average for you, and keep them for 7 days. That's the first consolidation, and that's the second consolidation. You can imagine how it works. So at that configuration, I can estimate when the disk will be full, because last month there was just in 60% usage, now it's 80%, so I can provide some kind of alert that yeah, disk becomes full soon. We are handling different metrics types. The first two are very basic. Those just are numbers, the counters and the gauges. Counters is something which is growing monotonically. The gauge can go and can be decreased as well. Those metrics can be consolidated very easily because numbers can be, so average can be computed for those numbers. There are structured metrics. What I showed you, the React get, number of gets for a specific node, that's called spirals, which means that spiral can count all the activities, what we had totally from the last restart, and we also can provide activities for the last minute. So I can show how many get happened in the last minute, and I can have some idea that whether the traffic will be growing in the future or it will be decreasing. Meters are just some kind of uptime like metrics, like we have some number and we are computing the 1, 5, 15 minutes moving averages. It's not so interesting, but the histogram is I think something very useful. we can show the distribution of the collected metrics in the picture like this. So this sample histogram is about the execution time of the React gets for the node 1 cluster. Those values are the microseconds, what a get operation required, and those numbers means the percentages. So it means that half of the requests have is 1.5 millisecond was to execute the get request, and we can also decide what are the points we need to concentrate on. It's just useful to show the distribution of the data, but if we want to display this 50, 90 order percentiles, we can also do that. We have nice notifications which provides information about the cluster or the Erlang nodes to the user, what's happening. We have two sources of information. What we provided on the notification tab are the errors collected and the alarms. We implemented the log capturing in a way that the log plugin has two agent modules called error logger handler and lager logger handler. Log plugin, when started, it knows that which nodes are running, and it will inject the two modules into those nodes and initialize them in a way that the error logger handler, the Wombat error logger handler, will be capture all the SASL logs, and the lager logger handler will be initialized in a way that it will be participated in the supervised lager logger hierarchy. When a logger handler gets a log message, then Wombat on the agent side, so in the manage node, check the log message severity. So it won't be delegated if the log message is some kind of about some kind of minor things. We just propagated only warning error and crash messages. And it's the same story with the lager logging plugin as well. This plugin is a bit more intrusive in a way that it modifies the error logger gen event in a way that it inserts new handlers. So we need to take care when the Wombat is down, we need to remove those error loggers in order to leave the manage nodes in a clean state. There were an interesting situation when some node was dying and it emits tons of log message, and those log messages killed not the Wombat server side, but since we want to be responsive, the log messages are collected real time on the UI side, so it killed the browser. So we needed to implement it some kind of log throttling, which means that if it's implemented in a way that if the error logger handler has a message queue length like 10 or 20, then it will drop all the log messages it received. So at least if we know that there's something wrong with the node, and Ops guy can SSH and analyze the situation much more. The third plugin is the alarm plugin, which is responsible for collecting raised alarms by applications in the manage node. We are using the SASL alarm handler, and we are using Wombat alarm handlers in the manage node. I think it's the most intrusive plugin from the three plugins we have, because it needs to be spawned a gen server, and the gen server periodically checking the conditions, whether if we are good in terms of memory on processes and so on. So when a manage node is down, and it's up again, we need to initialize that node again. And when Wombat is down, maybe for maintenance, then the managed nodes shouldn't collect or shouldn't send alarms to the Wombat in order that not to have some extra functionality in the managed node, but it's unwanted. I mentioned the 20 built-in alarms, what kind of alarms we have. We can check if a node is down. What Paul mentioned in the previous speak, that it's also a dangerous situation when we have old code. At least it can sign something that maybe an application upgrade wasn't successful or something like that. So we can also provide that alarm as well. We can say that when the process port memory or those things are approaching to their limits, there are two types of limits. There is a minor and there is a major limit. I think the minor limit is configured to 80% and the major is 90%. So if the number of processes is above the 80%, then it will be a minor message raised. We also have heavy weight alarms. We don't compute them very frequently. We are checking the application and module versions, and if a node family has a node which is differ in application or module version, then we raise an alarm. Maybe it's not intended that we have some kind of different module versions in the cluster. Maybe it's intended, and so on. We also have Erlang integration. Erlang is a relatively new library. It's implemented by the Erlang solutions. It wants to be some kind of flexible alarming framework. It can not just raise or clear alarms, but you can acknowledge, unacknowledge, comment an alarm, manually clear, and so on. We have several callback modules which are implementing the base of the alarm. So alarms will be kept in an ETS table because it's the default behavior. But if you don't need to do don't want to do that, then you can change that callback module and you can store the alarms in Amnesia or another database. The event module also can be replaced. Moreover, Wombat is using Alarm to collect alarms as well. So if an application is using Alarm, then we can collect all the alarms coming raised by the applications on that node. Okay, let's see if we have alarms here. We have just old code minors from the real cluster, and we have some information that those agent modules are old codes. That's intentional because I started Wombat several times before the demo, and those codes are loaded by the Wombat, so I can acknowledge the even clear those alarms. And then we have this system high memory watermark because my laptop is working very hard. So you can see the alarms in action, what I showed you before. The green rows are denoting the cleared alarms. So we had real cluster was down, then it's up again. We have this old code minor alarms, what we need to clear, and we have a disk capacity major. It's because the virtual machine has a boot partition almost full. It's not a big deal because we know that the boot partition won't grow, so we can configure alarm in order that it can skip that alarm and don't show that next time. Wombat also has a deployment feature with which we can define releases, the toolbar releases, what we heard in the last presentation. We can register infrastructure providers like Amazon EC2 or HP Public Cloud or Rackspace. And we also need to define node families with which I can make a connection between the releases. So if I would like to deploy my React release into Amazon EC2, then what kind of instances I would like to deploy that application on. And then we can also deploy applications. I don't want to go into details because Csaba, my colleague here, will have a tutorial session on Wednesday, and that's just about that, deploying applications with Wombat in the cloud. So that's nice, but what Wombat is really good for. So we can, I can show you some kind of, okay, we don't need so much data. Okay, we have some time. Yeah, we are in the old test node, and let's just define a function with which we can do some receive and spawn. Not 1,000, but 10,000 processes. Go back to the Wombat. What's the opinion of Wombat? We have metrics here, and we can see the protest info, number of processes. Yeah, you can see it collecting the protest numbers from the manage node. I can kill all those to show you how it monitors. Yeah, it will be pretty fast. So we just implemented this live metric feature with which you can describe a metric on the manage node. So in default, we don't want to get all the metrics, all the 100 metrics from the managed processes, because it's a huge amount of data and it's a huge amount of computing. But if you have a very good reason to check just one or two or three specific metrics, then you can compute them from the with this live metric feature, because as you can see, in every second, it will get the metric while you are interested in that. So we can detect the leaking processes. If the process number is growing, then we can at least see what's happening. We also can monitor not just the number of processes, but the message queue length. Let's just switch this off and monitor the message queue length. And we can see that we have 10,000 messages in the queue. We don't know which process is, because it's the sum of all messages in the sum of the all, size of the all message queues of the processes. So it's not something I advise to use in production, but we will work on a feature which doesn't require so much resource. So let's flush those messages. It was actually pretty quick, so we are processing those messages, and those messages are not bothering the system again. We have a With the help of the log plugin, we can catch the crash error and warning messages. So I wanted to demonstrate how it's working. We have a simple supervisor called this crash supervisor, and with that call, we are creating a new child. And just copy this, because I will kill that child, and go to the notification tab and select the test application. And crash the Gen server. So we saw some pop-ups which can be disabled as well. We are just enable the pop-ups, and we can see the error messages what Wombat collected. It's the lager message, so you can see that the origin is lager. You can see the date of the error message, and let's see the error logger message, because it's pretty printed, if an error can be pretty. So it's an intentional bug match in the server, we can easily see. We also can detect the old code. It's still present in the manage node, so we can we loaded the same module again. So we have a new alarm called old code minor. We can go to the alarm tab. You can see the badge that we have one new alarm arrived. We are very happy, and checking the new alarm, we can see here. We can also filter on the node as well. So normally, if we have a bigger screen, then this menu will be on the left side and the content will be on the right side. It's on the bottom because we are using Bootstrap, and Bootstrap is a responsive user interface framework. But it means that you can access Wombat by mobile, because it can show the user interface accordingly to the resolution. We can also detect the uneven load balancing, or if for some reason the node 3 doesn't get any GET requests, then we can easily spot that out, because each node have a massive number, not massive number, but fair amount of a number of GETs, but it has 0, and now I rewrote the script in order that it puts some load on each node, and everything is normal again. So I think what is going the basic use cases or the specific use cases will be decided by the customers, by the users who will use Wombat. I don't know. I just give some kind of idea what it is good for. We have some future plans. We are working on that. We have so many plans that we are working on 100%. If you are interested in Wombat and want to get, I don't know whether a copy or some kind of license or some kind of how to put it, commercial edition of Wombat, then you can ask Mladen. There is a guy here demoing Wombat, and you can access. You can ask some kind of access for the Wombat. So, thank you for the attention. If you have any questions, then please ask. Yeah, Csaba will handle the mic.
How much is the overhead of running Wombat?
Yeah, that's a good question. We have several metrics which require just microseconds to be executed, but we have such metrics like the those number of message queues. So it iterates, basically it iterates all the processes, and it calls the process information and the dictionary size. We have, you can check, we have several such metrics. I think they are useful on development environment or in staging, but to be used in production, I personally, I don't recommend, if we can make them work faster, or if we can access those information from the Erlang VM, then we can show that happily. So yeah, if you ask all the 100 metrics, then in this laptop it requires 300-400 milliseconds, milliseconds, but then it means that it runs Wombat and React and other React nodes as well. But I rather use the simpler ones. Log and alarming doesn't have such restrictions.
Maybe I missed a joint later. For an existing code base, does it require any extra instrumentation in the code to be able to use Wombat?
I think not in the code, in the VM. So it doesn't instrument the code. It just asks the Erlang virtual machine metrics, what it can access through the process info, system information, and system monitoring. Mm-hmm. If you have some kind of business-related metrics, like the number of online users or the number of, bad passwords gave by the users, you can specify such a metric with foursome, and you can make some counter or spiral, and Wombat can show you. So in that case, maybe you need to instrument your code in that way.
And is it necessary to run Wombat on the same VM of Erlang,
where the application runs? No, it's a remote application. Mm-hmm. I think it should be run on the same local network because it uses the EPMD and the distribution ports. But we tried to monitor Amazon nodes through the internet. It's not a good idea, so I don't recommend it. It can possible, yeah, but not in the same VM. No, it's just for development.
Can you include an OTP app with the code that you want on your monitored nodes instead of having Wombat inject the code?
That's a nice idea. Since Wombat is under heavy development, then it means that the agent codes are changing on a daily basis. If we have some kind of peace time or something like that, then maybe it's why not we can provide some kind of module. Yeah, because I just thought that what kind of considerations we need to take care when there is an application upgrade, and I understand.
I noticed that you aggregate logs and you can search. So what do you use in the backend for log aggregation and search?
Now we are using simple disk logs. It's very fast because it's just a binary file which is appended. But what we need to do is to search backward in the disk log. And it's not very good at it. So somehow we need to change the implementation. Either we need to do something with disk log and modify something in OTP, or if we don't do that, then we can implement some kind of sequential file-based or I don't know what kind of backend. But now the disk log implementation, we definitely need to replace, because if we have just some number of logs, that's fine. But if we have a massive amount of logs, then it will require so much memory we don't want to use.
But you could use still like external services, like if you have an integration layer, and then if you use Splunk on the other side, you could use their API for displaying everything.
Yeah. We definitely want to integrate those tools. So those are the future plans. Mm-hmm. Yes. There is another.
Does Wombat have an API so I can sort of add and remove nodes and set and clear alarms programmatically?
Pardon?
Does Wombat have an API?
API. We want to provide some kind of plugin SDK, which means that you will have some kind of API and you can write plugins, which means that you need to specify the UI components, the Wombat side component, and the agent modules. It using some kind of eventing by the GPOS in Wombat. So if you, a node is up or down or something like that, its application installed in there, then you will be notified, your plugin will be notified, and you need to handle that situation. You can also collect all the live nodes, the running nodes from the topology service. That's why it's the base service, because every plugin is using topology service. And based on those information, you can write an Amnesia plugin, which is also among our plans to catch all the Amnesia logs. And
how about for adding and removing nodes to Wombat?
There is an UI API, there is a REST API, and if you are connected to Wombat, then you can also use the Wombat modules, because that's very clear, but the REST API is the preferred way. Moreover, there is an S-Script tool which using REST API to remove nodes. Yes.